Queen Elizabeth is perhaps one of the most recognizable figures in the world, but do you know who she is as an individual? She has been on the throne for decades and has seen Great Britain through years of war, scandals, and prime ministers. Here's what you don't know about her. Not a lot of people can say that they knew their spouse for most of their life, but Queen Elizabeth can. Elizabeth met her late husband, Prince Philip, in 1934 when she was just 8 years old. They met at the wedding of Princess Marina of Greece, and the seed of their love was planted. Their paths crossed again when Elizabeth was 13 and Philip was 18, when the royal family was visiting the Royal Naval College. Philip was training as a cadet, and apparently there were instant sparks between them. Margaret Rhodes, Elizabeth's cousin, said, as noted by Vanity Fair, she never looked at anyone else. They remained married for over 70 years. Queen Elizabeth has addressed Great Britain countless times, but she was called to speak to the country for the first time as a young teen. As noted by the National World War II Museum, Elizabeth, like many children in London, was sent away from the city during the war, adding distance between the children and the heavy bombing the city was experiencing. She and her sister, Princess Margaret, retreated to Windsor Castle, and it was in the castle's drawing room where she addressed the nation for the first time during the BBC's Children's Hour. Thousands of you in this country have had to leave your homes and be separated from your fathers and mothers. My sister Margaret Rose and I feel so much for you, as we know from experience what it means to be away from those you love most of all. To you living in new surroundings, we send a message of true sympathy. As noted by History.com, Elizabeth pleaded with her father to let her contribute to the war effort, so when she was 18 years old, she joined the Women's Auxiliary Territorial Service. Her official title within the Watts was Second Subaltern Elizabeth Windsor, and she began her training in London. The Queen, during wartime, became a military truck driver and a mechanic. To this day, Queen Elizabeth is the only female member within the British royal family to have served in the military, and she remains the only surviving head of state in the world who served during the Second World War. Elizabeth continued to conform to the scarcity and demand of wartime, even after her service came to an end, and she used ration coupons to purchase the material needed for her wedding gown, as austerity measures were still in place in 1947. Queen Elizabeth has had standing appointments with the United Kingdom's Prime Minister throughout her reign, but one made a lasting impression. As noted by British Heritage Travel, the Queen has met with 15 Prime Ministers, but it was Winston Churchill who truly impacted her. The meetings between Elizabeth and Churchill often lasted as long as 2 hours, with conversations ranging from their personal lives to political concerns. According to politician Roy Jenkins, Churchill had a near idolatry for the Queen and for the royal family as a whole. When Churchill retired in 1955, Queen Elizabeth sent him a handwritten letter, expressing to him that never would another prime minister, quote, be able to hold the place of my first prime minister, to whom both my husband and I owe so much. When Queen Elizabeth attended Churchill's funeral in 1965, she went against standard procedure and marked her attendance before his family arrived. Queen Elizabeth may not be a political figure, but she has immense influence on the world stage, so it makes sense that she has met U.S. presidents. As noted by CNN, 12 presidents have been elected since Elizabeth ascended to the throne. She has met all but two of them, Lyndon B. Johnson and current U.S. President Joe Biden, whom she is hosting in the summer of 2021.
Visits by American presidents always remind us of the close and long-standing friendship between the United Kingdom and the United States.
Former U.S. President Bill Clinton said of her, "She's a highly intelligent woman who knows a lot about the world. I always marvel when we meet at what a keen judge she is of human events. I think she's a very impressive person." His sentiments were seconded by Barack Obama, who was very clear with his thoughts on the monarch. "There's one last thing that I should mention that I love about Great Britain, and that is the Queen." Life as a royal looks a lot like crowns and castles, so it's a wonder how much Queen Elizabeth is worth. As noted by The Independent, the public pay just shy of $50 million a year to support the Queen, and about $500,000 of that once went directly to Prince Philip. The British royal family is the most expensive royal institution in Europe, and the Queen herself is reportedly worth about $412 million. But as you may have figured, the Queen's personal wealth only accounts for a fraction of the wealth of the royal family. As noted by Forbes, the crown is worth about $28 billion, and a lot of that wealth comes from assets and real estate. The crown estate is worth $19.5 billion, the Duchy of Cornwall is worth $1.3 billion, Kensington Palace is worth $630 million, the crown estate in Scotland is worth $592 million, and of course, Buckingham Palace is worth $4.9 billion. Forbes also noted that the Queen likely has an additional $500 million in personal assets. Here's something that is very interesting. The Queen doesn't hold a passport or a driver's license. And yes, there is reasoning behind both. As noted by History.com, Queen Elizabeth has traveled to more than 115 countries as the United Kingdom's reigning monarch. And no, she doesn't have a passport full of stamps. Every passport in Great Britain is issued in Queen Elizabeth's name, so naturally, she doesn't really need one herself. Similarly, she doesn't need a driver's license, and that hasn't stopped her from getting behind the driver's wheel and taking her Jaguar or Range Rover for a spin. Queen Elizabeth has a number of enduring pet names given to her by her family. As noted by Harper's Bazaar, one of the Queen's oldest nicknames is Lilibet. She reportedly couldn't pronounce her name when she was little, so her father, King George VI, used her own slip-up and turned it into an enduring nickname. It has also been heard through the grapevine that Prince Philip called Elizabeth Cabbage, although we're not entirely sure why. Of course, the Queen has picked up a number of nicknames as she has occupied the role of grandmother and great-grandmother. As noted by the Daily Mail, Prince William used to call his grandmother Gary. Apparently, William fell over while in Buckingham Palace as a young child and called out for Gary. A guest didn't know who he was talking about, but the Queen simply said, "I'm Gary." He hasn't learned to say granny yet. William's own child, Prince George, calls the Queen Gan-Gan, adding to her long list of nicknames. Where there's the Queen, there's typically a corgi, and that is not by accident. As noted by the Washington Post, Queen Elizabeth has owned 30 corgis in her lifetime, having loved the dog breed since she was little. In fact, the Queen bred corgis for a number of years and had a royal line of the breed. When her last royal corgi, Willow, passed away, it was a huge blow. An insider at Buckingham Palace told the Daily Mail, "She has mourned every one of her corgis over the years, but she has been more upset about Willow's death than any of them. Willow was far more than a dog, but was a significant thread that tied the Queen all the way back to her years as a teenager with her parents." The source added, "It really does feel like the end of an era. For many, many years, she bred and raised corgis, and to think that the last one has now gone is something of a milestone." As noted by Harper's Bazaar, the Queen is fluent in French, having picked up the language as a child due to her French and Belgian governess. When she made a speech at France's 2014 state banquet and read her speech in both English and French, she surprised a number of people with her abilities.
Je me rappelle le plaisir que j'ai eu à découvrir ce beau pays.
Having the ability to speak fluent French seems like a useful skill for the traveling monarch. The royal website says, "She often has cause to use it when speaking to ambassadors and heads of state from French-speaking countries, and when visiting French-speaking areas of Canada. It would not be surprising if the Queen knew a few German phrases too, since her husband was fluent in the language." This is maybe the most random detail about Queen Elizabeth, but she owns all the whales, dolphins, sturgeons, and swans that swim in British waters. As noted by Reader's Digest, the swan is a symbol of Britain's monarchy, and as such, the Queen owns all swans that swim on, quote, certain stretches of the Thames River and its surrounding tributaries. Now moving on to dolphins. Because, yes, it does sound weird that the Queen of England owns all the dolphins that swim in UK waters. As noted by Time, a statute dating all the way back to 1324 states that the ruler of England, quote, shall have whales and sturgeons taken in the sea or elsewhere within the realm. All these years later, the statute is still in place, so all porpoises, dolphins, whales, and sturgeons under the Queen's ownership are known as fishes royal. If any one of the mammals is captured within 3 miles of Great Britain, or if one washes up to shore, it can be claimed on the Queen's behalf. If you know anything about the Brits, then you know that a good cup of English tea is a staple in every home. There's tea in the morning, tea in the afternoon, tea when it's hot, cold, raining, sunny, you name it. And while it's safe to assume that Queen Elizabeth partakes in the grand tradition of English tea drinking, she has a staple cocktail regimen every day that she does not waver on. The Queen's cousin, Margaret Rhodes, once revealed the monarch's go-to cocktails. As noted by The Independent, Elizabeth has a gin and Dubonnet drink accompanied with lemon and ice before lunch. With lunch, she'll have a dry martini, and then she finishes off the evening with a glass of champagne. By the United Kingdom's government standards, the Queen might qualify as a binge drinker, given that she has 6 alcoholic units per day, but it doesn't seem like she'll waver from tradition anytime soon. There are some very odd traditions within the royal institution, and with those traditions comes the servants who fulfill certain roles. For instance, there is Her Majesty's botanist and an astronomer royal. There's the keeper of the Queen's stamps, literally someone overseeing the Queen's stamp collection, and a royal shoe wearer. That's someone on Queen Elizabeth's staff who wears her shoes so that she doesn't have to go through the uncomfortable break-in period herself. But of all the jobs that are close to the Queen, the oddest might be the piper to the sovereign. As noted by Business Insider, the role was invented in 1843 by Queen Victoria, and every morning at 9 a.m., a piper plays the bagpipes under the Queen's window for 15 minutes. So there's really no need for the Queen to ever set an alarm clock, because the piper will play every weekday morning like clockwork, ushering the new day in with the sounds of the bagpipes.
What is that?
I think it's the Dying Cat Parade.
Check out one of our newest videos right here! Plus, even more list videos about your favorite royals are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.